Okay, so let me recall you where we stand last time. So what we discussed is this general equilibrium theory, which is a theory, mathematical theory to describe economies as a whole. And what we showed is that under some circumstances, which are convexity assumptions, etc., and complete market and perfect market, perfect competition, then one can ensure that the allocation that is reached by markets will be Pareto efficient. And so that any Pareto efficient allocation can be reached by transfers. Okay, so these are the welfare theorems. So in this sense, markets solve this problem of conciling the individual optimization problem of each of the individuals and to make it essentially a global optimum. Okay. And so this is what we said and what was realized really long ago by Adam Smith. Okay, so now let's start discussing markets. So what are financial markets good for? Okay, so the idea of markets, financial markets, has to do with uncertainty and risk, okay? So the problem is that, say, you may want to reallocate your wealth across time in order to deal with uncertainty and risk. If you think about it, pension schemes are pension funds do this job. And also insurance contracts are a way to deal with risk, okay? So we pay an insurance contract today to cover us from risk that we could incur in the future, okay? And so now let me discuss a very simple problem just to give you an idea of what is the main conceptual issue, okay? So imagine that we are in a very simple world, and in this world there are just 2 days, today and tomorrow. And tomorrow there are two different situations that can arise. Either it is rainy or it is sunny, okay? So if it is rainy, I will need an umbrella. If it is sunny, I will need sunglasses, okay? So the question is that if I have a certain amount of money now, then I don't know what is the best way to do. Should I buy an umbrella or should I buy sunglasses? Okay, whatever I do, I may end up in the wrong state tomorrow, okay? So now you could think that one particular solution to this problem is to have what are called contingent commodity markets, okay? What is a contingent commodity? So a contingent commodity is a commodity, a good, that is conditional on a certain condition, okay? So for example, sunglasses if rain is a contingent commodity that is equal to sunglasses if it rains tomorrow, and it is equal to nothing if it will not rain tomorrow, okay? And so you can have essentially a contingent commodity market for each possible contingent commodity. And if these markets, so you should have a price for each of these contingent objects. And so the idea is that you can solve the problem if these markets are there, then you can solve your problem by going and shopping and buying a sunglasses sun. You buy this good here, sunglasses if sun, and umbrella if rain. And then this means that if tomorrow it will be sunny, you will have sunglasses. If tomorrow it is rainy, you will have an umbrella, okay? So this is the idea of, general equilibrium theory. And so with this idea, it is enough to have enough markets for all these contingent commodities, and you can solve the problem of risk and uncertainty, of dealing with uncertainty. Okay, so the problem is that in reality, these markets are very difficult. In reality, they do not exist, and they are very difficult to implement. Okay, so for example, no one will buy umbrella. If sun, so this contingent commodity will not be very much. So if you think of a shop that sells umbrella if sun, this shop will not have many customers. So then this is why essentially financial markets can be useful. Okay, so let me give you an idea of how financial markets can solve this problem without introducing contingent commodity markets. Okay, imagine that there is a financial market, and in this financial market there are two stocks. Okay, one is what is called a bond, and one is what is called a stock. So a bond is it is a price of one today, and it will give a return of one tomorrow. So I give to the bank $1 today, and the bank will give me $1 tomorrow, okay? Instead, there is another stock, the risky stock S, that today costs one, and tomorrow it will pay back one plus U if it is sunny, and one minus D if it is rainy. So you see, this stock is a random variable, okay? It depends on the state that will be realized in the future, okay? Now, imagine that I want to have a certain amount sea rain if it rains, and this is how much I need to buy an umbrella tomorrow, and a certain amount sea sun of euros tomorrow, which is what I need to buy sunglasses, okay? So the idea is that I go I can go into the market and buy a portfolio of ZB units of bond and ZS units of the asset in such a way that my return tomorrow, which is ZB times one plus one plus U times ZS if it is sunny, okay? And these are the expression if it is raining, so that the value of my portfolio tomorrow will be exactly equal to what I will need, okay? Now you see, this is just two equations for two unknown, and so they can be solved, and I can find exactly what are the values of ZB and ZS, what is my portfolio, by inverting this equation. And so I can find out how much this portfolio will cost, how much I have to spend today in order to have tomorrow what I need to buy either sunglasses or umbrella, okay? And this is just the value of the portfolio today, which is the sum of these two things. Now, the interesting thing that one finds is that this price of the portfolio can be expressed in this simple case in this way, which is essentially, if you think these are two numbers that add up to one, okay? So this can be interpreted as probabilities. So it can be interpreted as an expected value over some probability distribution, which in this case is t divided by u plus d, or u divided by u plus d, of what is the value, the risky value of my contingent claim tomorrow, okay? And this is actually, you can generalize this example, and this is essentially the basis of what is called asset pricing theory. And you can generalize this example and develop a theory where essentially every contingent claim, every value, any random value of the sum of money tomorrow can be expressed as the expected value over the same probability distribution of this random value, okay? And this this is really interesting for several reasons. One, because essentially what you see in all this game, what you manage to do is to get rid of risk altogether, okay? And the other thing is that you can measure how much this contract will cost you, this portfolio will cost you, just by taking an average over a probability distribution, which is called a risk neutral probability distribution, okay? The interesting thing is that this probability distribution has nothing to do with the real probability distribution, with the real probability that tomorrow it will rain or tomorrow it will be sunny. Okay, it is a probability distribution that is only derived from the prices, as in this example, of the different stocks. Okay, now, this is very, very nice and looks like magic. So it is important to realize what are the assumptions that we took. Well, first of all, we assume that it is perfect competition, so that when you buy in the financial market, the prices are not affected by how much you buy, okay? And this is not exactly true. Then also we have assumed that we have full information, that we know what are the returns, or we know what is the probability distribution of returns of the different assets in the financial market tomorrow. And this is also somewhat of a strong assumption. Also, well, another assumption is that, well, this works because U and D are positive. You see that if U and D are not positive, then this probability distribution can be negative. So, and in this case, this game does not work. So there is a condition that is called no arbitrage that has to be satisfied. In other words, the prices should be such that there is no portfolio that will make a positive gain for sure without running any risk, okay? And this is the no arbitrage hypothesis. Okay, and then the most important thing is that you see we solve this problem because there is a 2x2 so an equation for so there are two equations for two unknowns. So there are essentially two equations for the two states and for two variables which are the two stops. Okay. So what if now we have three states? Okay. What if tomorrow it can be sunny, rainy, or cloudy? And if it is cloudy, you don't need either sunglasses or rain. Okay. Now it is clear that if there are three if there are three states tomorrow, then you cannot no longer solve this problem, which means you can no longer eliminate completely the risk. Okay, so this assumption that the number of states is equal to the number of stocks is what is called the complete market assumption. Okay, and when the number of states is larger than the number of stocks, which is typically the case, then we say that the markets are incomplete. Okay, and in this situation, you can not get away with the risk, okay? So this is one way in which financial markets are designed to solve this problem of dealing with risk and uncertainty, okay? So, and indeed, if you think about this is what financial markets have been doing in the last, so trying to enforce these two conditions, perfect competition and market completeness, is what has driven the evolution of financial markets, at least in the last 30 years, okay? Because you see, the reason why financial markets are not perfectly competitive is because the market participants are there are not many market participants, so that some of the participants have monopoly power. Okay, they can fix the price. But if you allow all participants, I mean, if you allow many participants to access the market, then markets will become more competitive. Okay. And this is what has happened. So, for example, this is the growth of hedge funds in the last in the last decades. Okay. And the other thing is that if you want markets to be financial markets to be complete, then you should allow the creation of new stocks, which have nothing to do with the standard stocks like, I don't know, cotton or say gold or oil, okay? But they have to do with financial securities or derivatives like options or swaps, et cetera, or, what has been happening in the last, say, 30 years is the development of these credit derivatives, which are essentially assets which are built on other assets, okay? And these other assets are based on credit instruments like mortgages or say credit defaults swaps of firms, etc. Okay, so the idea behind the proliferation of all these financial instruments is that essentially the market will become more and more complete, so it will approach these limits where it is, we have a complete market, and then we can get away with our uncertainty and risk about the future with asset pricing theory, okay? So So we have questions. I know this is a lot of stuff, but I hope you got the main idea.
I have a question.
Yes, please.
Why the increasing number of assets leads to the completeness of market?
Yes, so because essentially if you have many assets, so you can think of these many assets like in the example that I showed you as vectors, okay? As random variables in a space of in this space where, say, every component of this vector is the realization of the return of this financial instrument for a particular state of the world, okay? For a particular contingency, okay? So if you have many of these vectors which are linearly independent, then you can use them as a basis to essentially reproduce any other vector. This is the idea of completeness, okay?
Yeah.
And if instead you have your spaces, the number of states is very high and you have few vectors, then you cannot reproduce all possible say contingent claims or all possible vectors, okay?
Okay. Thank you.
Sorry, I have a question. I couldn't understand what do you mean by no arbitrage?
No arbitrage means that given the assets that you can trade in a market, there is no portfolio that you can form in such a way that this portfolio for sure will give you a positive return, a non-negative return, a return which is, say, non-negative, which means that you will not lose anything, but that at least in one state will give you a positive, strictly positive return, okay? So this condition is a condition, if you think about this picture of, say, assets as vectors, it means that the space of vectors that you have must be convex, in the sense that there is no way in which you can combine vectors in order to have a vector which has only non-negative components. Okay, so does this help, Benjamin? We will see this in another example, okay? So no arbitrage is also called no free lunch hypothesis, okay? Which means that there is no way in which you can get lunch and you without paying, okay? So you if you, well, of course, you can get it from your mom, but.
Sorry, I have another question. This no arbitrage is means an outcome of a complete market. Means why to again assume no arbitrage? Because complete market will have a number of assets equals to number of stocks, and there is no risk anyway.
No, so these two are two different things, okay? So this no arbitrage hypothesis is, you can think of it as the second law of thermodynamics of financial markets, okay? It tells you that you cannot get anything for free. You cannot get something for free, okay? The completeness instead tells you that you can always represent whatever contingent claim, whatever, say, random variable, random return in the future as a linear combination of the returns of the stocks that you can buy in the market. Okay? So these are two different concepts. Okay? So if you want to understand more about this, I suggest you to look at the first chapter of this book by Pliska that I put in the references, because this explains very easily all these concepts on the basis of essentially linear algebra. Okay?
Okay, thanks.
Okay, so, well, this was a very brief introduction to finance. What I want to do in the next half an hour is to address the question, well, we have learned all these nice principles, all these nice theories about economies and financial markets, but what do these tell us about real economies and real financial markets? Okay, so of course we have seen, for example, that we can discuss an economy with two goods and two consumers. But what we would like to do is actually discuss, understand what are the properties of an economy where there are millions of firms and consumers and millions of goods, okay? And likewise, we would like to have to see how these ideas of complete markets, et cetera, work in the case where markets become very, very complex, okay, with thousands and millions of different stocks, okay? So the idea to do this is essentially the same idea of statistical mechanics, that is to pick some theory at the micro scale and try to derive from this consequences for the behavior at the macro scale. Okay, and this type of idea that you could use this set of statistical mechanics to study also human society actually dates back to Ludwig Boltzmann. Okay, he himself thought that you should be able to do statistical mechanics of economies and financial markets. Okay, so statistical mechanics, as you guess know, is what allows you, set of tools that allows you to go from what is the theory of the microstate to a theory of the macroscopic state of collective behavior. And the properties of this is that essentially when you go from the microscopic behavior to the macroscopic behavior, what you find is that collective behavior is largely, is very robust. It's very robust in the sense that even if you take very different gases, which are very different composition, the type of laws that they obey are essentially, they are very similar, okay? And actually you can put them one on top of the other if you scale the variables properly, okay? So this type of, this is the idea that essentially does not really matter, microscopic details do not really matter, okay? So the idea is that if this is so, then essentially you can study very simple model and then think that essentially you can compare the behavior of simple model with the real world data, okay? So this is the general idea, okay? And so we will try to do is, I will try to explain you a few attempts to do these things for economies, okay? Okay, so let's start with economies. Okay, so as I told you, the general equilibrium theory tells us that economies are these three main actors: consumers, firms, and markets. And consumers buy goods and maximize utility. Firms transforms inputs into outputs and maximize profits. And markets say clears prices, so fixes prices so that demand matches supply. Okay. So now you can think at this, so mathematically you have a space of commodity. Everything is taking place in a space of, where this X is a vector of quantities of different goods. Each component is a quantity of a different good. So you have this big C, capital C, commodities. Then on one side you have these consumers, and these consumers have initial endowments, and then they have a utility function. And what they do is to maximize the utility function subject to some budget constraints. Okay, and the budget constraints is essentially whatever they consume, they should be able to afford whatever they consume. Okay, then there are firms. Firms essentially transform inputs into outputs, and they have a specific function, which is essentially their technology by which they do so, and essentially they have a profit. And what they do is to maximize their profit, okay, to optimize the inputs, how much inputs they should buy in order to maximize the profit, okay? And then the markets essentially adjust these prices in such a way that essentially the demand, which is what is on this side, which is the demand for good A from the consumers, and from the inputs of the firms, should equal the supply, which is essentially the endowments plus the outputs, okay? Now, essentially, what I want to do is to take a model of this type, where essentially both the number of firms and the number of goods go to infinity, but with a fixed ratio N divided by C, okay? And this ratio, you can think of it as a measure of industrial development. So how many technologies you have in your economies, in your economy, as with respect to the goods, to the different goods, okay? Okay, so now the goods themselves, you can think they are divided into different classes. So there are primary goods. These are primary goods. These are things that you say dig out of the ground or that grow from on the trees. So these are things that you don't need, that are already there in the initial endowments, okay? Then there are final goods. Final goods are what the consumers care about. So the consumer eat only a certain number of goods, a certain type of goods. They don't eat, they don't consume all the goods, okay? So we don't eat anything that, we find, that we can dig out of the ground, okay? Then there is waste. Waste are, notice that some of the final goods can also be primary goods, such as apples, for example, okay? But some of the final goods, like for example, the iPhone, okay, does not grow on the trees, okay? It has to be produced, okay? And so then there are waste are goods that are not final, and that they are just they can be primary or not, but that are in surplus in our economy. Okay, and then there are intermediate goods. Intermediate goods are goods that are not primary; they are produced, but then they are used to produce a final good, which is what we care about. Okay, for example, you can think that a part of your car is an intermediate good, or say a computer component like a chip is an intermediate good, because in itself it is not something that we use for consumption, but it is used to assemble things that we use for consumption, okay? Okay, so then these are the consumers. The consumer are a separable utility function, which makes life easier. And and it only depends on the final goods, okay? And also this thing tells you that say a priori, so at time zero, say goods are different because some of them are primary, some of them are not primary, okay? But a posteriori, each of the final good is as good as any other good, okay? And finally, firms have these linear production functions, which means that essentially the amount of inputs, the amount of output that is produced depends linearly with the amount of inputs, okay? So each firm, the technology of each firm is essentially a vector in this space of commodities, okay? Okay, so now, do you have questions on this? I know this is a little bit complicated, but it's essentially putting mathematics into what we have been saying. Okay, so one issue here is that what I'm going to assume is that this, you know, I have an infinite number of a number n of firms that is going to infinity. And I'm going to assume that each production function is drawn at random. So each of these vectors is drawn at random for each firm, okay? So this means that we are going to study the general equilibrium of a large random economy. Okay. Okay. So now the nice thing is that this can be done analytically with tools of statistical mechanics. I don't want to get into any detail, just scare you with math. But so in the end, you can figure out what are the order parameters and reduce this problem in a way which is tractable. And also there's a lot of insight that you can get from these saddle point equations, et cetera, et cetera. But let me just discuss the results, okay? Now the result is that essentially, if you look at phase diagram like this one, where here you put this N, which is essentially an index of industrial development. What is the fraction of technologies in your economy to the number of goods? And here is the fraction of primary goods, okay? Then you find two phases. So one phase, which is essentially a phase where your economy does not take off, okay? There is no production in this. All the firms are not producing anything in this region here, okay? And then you have a sharp transition to a regime where essentially instead the firms start producing, okay? So you can think of this as essentially an industrial revolution. as the number of goods increases, as the number of technologies, as you invent more and more technology, at a certain point, your economy will undergo a phase transition where mass production will start, okay? And you see this, the scale of production of firms jumps to a positive value, and the fraction of technologies that are adopted are zero up to this point, and then they jump to a finite value, okay? So this is essentially like industrial revolution. And you see that this industrial revolution occurs before where in places is expected to occur before in places which have a large fraction of primary goods, okay? An economy where there are very few primary goods will not experience this industrial revolution as early as one that has a lot of access to primary goods, okay? And so this is interesting because you can think that essentially industrial revolution occurred mainly in countries that had access, the bigger colonial empire, so had wide access to primary goods. Whereas essentially countries that base their economy on just one single very abundant resource, which is like oil or gold, minerals, etc., typically have their industrial development has been slowed down a lot. Okay. Okay, so this phase transition is very interesting. So also, if you study this...
Oh, you have a question.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, in the previous slide, I couldn't get... means this small n is the ratio of the number of firms to the number of commodities, right?
This n, yes.
A small n, huh? So even a small n is 2, which... it may mean for firms producing, say, 2 commodities, then without any primary good, you have almost industrial revolution.
Sorry, you have?
You can have an industrial revolution.
Yeah, so.
Means the left graph, fraction of primary goods as a function of small n.
Yes. If you have a few primary goods, then you need more technologies to get into this regime where you have mass production, okay? Because otherwise, on this side of the phase diagram, you have all these technologies, but they are not used, okay? The firms, so the scale of production, how much the firms produce is equal to zero, okay? So if you have access to large number of goods, primary goods, then this transition occurs needs less technologies, okay? Does this model of macroeconomics from microbehavior consider the interrelation between different final products and primary goods? There are no substitution effects, if this is because essentially the utility function is separable, okay? But other than that, you have all the general equilibrium effects between primary and final goods, okay? And I'm going to discuss a few of these in the next slide, okay? do this number of intermediate goods. Okay, so the number, I'm going to get to this in the next slide. So let me first discuss what are the recipes for economic growth that you get out of this model, okay? So essentially you can compute what is the analog of a GDP, which is essentially the total value of the goods produced, is the total amount of money that flows in the economy. And you can see that essentially as you increase the industrial development, this GDP increases and then it saturates. So you have these two regimes. But also the important thing is to ask, what should you do if you are in a particular situation? What should you do in order to increase GDP? Okay, and you find that when the industrial development is below a certain critical value, let's say, which is essentially two in this model, then in order to increase GDP, you should invent new technologies. So introduce a new technology, increase N, move in this direction, okay? But when you are in this other regime, which is this regime where GDP is saturated, what you should do to increase GDP is introduce new goods like the iPhone or the iPod, okay? Something that, a new good that didn't exist before, and it's invented, okay? But the technologies to produce that goods were already there, okay? Okay, so this is interesting because it essentially tells you that, more or less, we went through this through these phases. So let me get to the issue of the different goods. So if you compare these economies in different stages of development. So what you will find is that, in this, when you are at lower stage of development, so there is a distinction between, so this is a PDF probability distribution of how many goods are consumed by the consumers, okay? And you see that there are a lot of abundant primary goods and few scarce manufactured goods. But as you increase industrial developments, then essentially the amount of produced goods increases, and more and more the primary goods are used for production. Okay, and also you have that in the initial stage of development, the economy is very inefficient, produces a lot of waste. But as you enter deeper into this phase, the waste is decreases. Let me get to intermediate goods, okay? So imagine that now you are in this situation here, up here. What you could do is to introduce new goods, okay? So this increase the number of goods C with the same number of technologies, okay? So this would correspond to moving along this line here, okay? What is interesting is that essentially, as I told you, the GDP will increase up to a certain point, and this is what you see here. But then after a certain point, it will start decreasing, and at a certain point, your economy will collapse, okay? So this is very strange. So by introducing more and more goods into an economy, you may also drive it to collapse, okay? Because, and when you can study what is the mathematical reason for this. I will not get into details. And but just to mention that the number of intermediate goods in this economy is not set a priori. It is the equilibrium of the economy that decides which firms operate, which firm does not operate, which good is an intermediate good, and which good is waste. Okay? I hope I reply to your question. Okay? So, after all, I mean, this model is interesting because, if you read accounts of the last four centuries of industrial dynamics, then what you see is that more or less our economies have been first moving in this direction, increasing, their technological repertoire, expanding the technological repertoire, and then essentially moving in the other direction. So, which means essentially expanding the number of intermediate goods. So, for example, if you think about how a machine, a car, was built in the early 20th century, so there was a firm that was just taking a raw material like wood, metal, leather, et cetera, all in the same place. And then there was a production process that were just producing a car, okay? Nowadays, essentially, if you take a car, the firm does not even, it buys different pieces from different other firms. So they may buy the steering wheel from a particular place. The motor may come from a different firms, et cetera, et cetera. Okay? This is like, there is more and more of this outsourcing. There has been more and more of this outsourcing, okay? Okay, so do you have questions on this?
I couldn't understand the collapse which you described. With more number of produced goods, why should the GDP of a country collapse?
Sorry, I didn't understand.
And no, I went to point out that you mentioned that the GDP of an economy will collapse if the number of produced goods becomes larger and larger.
Yes, yes.
I couldn't get the reason behind that.
Okay, so one reason is so the intermediate goods are mathematically, they are special goods because essentially they impose a homogeneous constraints on production. Whereas a primary good, if you go back to the definition of an economy, okay, so this one, okay, so you see that essentially you have a market clearing condition for each good, okay, so each commodity, each good imposes a constraint, okay? So if you have an intermediate good, then the Y here is not there because it is not a primary good. And the W here is not, and the X here is not there because it is not consumed, okay? So it is a linear, it is a linear constraint on just production, okay? Okay? It's a homogeneous constraint on production, okay? Whereas if you have a primary good, this does not impose a linear, an homogeneous constraint, okay? And so if you have too many homogeneous constraints, then you may have that the set of feasible production plans may shrink just to zero, okay? And this is why you have this phase transition, essentially. I mean, this is why here you have no production. This is why you have this industrial revolution, okay? So you can understand this from a mathematical point of view, okay? Okay, so now I think we just have, let me spend 3 minutes. I hope you don't mind if I take a little bit longer, but I would ask like just to tell you that the same type of ideas can be applied to deal with a complex financial market. Okay, so you remember this financial market where we had these stocks and we have these portfolios. Now you can essentially think of generalizing this picture to a case where you have many states, big omega states, and many assets, say large N assets, okay? And you think at a system where you have industry, banks that essentially trade these stocks, these offer these financial instruments to investors, and these investors form a portfolio, and the way they do this is to find a Z which maximizes their utility. Okay, so you have an utility. So this mathematically is not so much a different setting than before. And then you can think about, say, financial innovation. Again, it's like inventing a new asset, okay? And again, you can study the situation where the number of assets goes to infinity and also the number of states goes to infinity, okay? And you can draw these states at random, so you can look at, a large random financial markets, okay? And there are two main variables here. One is what is called financial complexity, the ratio between the number of assets and the number of states. And the other one is essentially the risk premium. So how much the banks charge for, the assets they are trading, okay? Okay, then you do a lot of math and you use all these tricks from statistical mechanics. And in the end, you end with a phase diagram which is very similar to the one we discussed before, okay? You have a situation where your financial market is stable, which is up here, where essentially the optimization problem of the consumer is well-defined. And a situation here where financial market is unstable because essentially you have a runoff solutions, okay? And the phase transition, which is this line here, you have the situation where the solution exists, but is degenerate. There are, say, flat directions, okay? And actually, the interesting thing is that complete markets correspond to exactly these points, where essentially you have these flat directions. These flat directions are important because at these points, the susceptibility diverges, which is essentially tells you how much the portfolio of investors change if you change the price of what they want to buy, okay? So in this line, essentially you get what is essentially an instability, okay? So let me cut a very long story short, so you can also understand why is it that a financial market would tend towards this line when you increase the number of assets. And this happens because essentially when the financial industry introduces a new asset, what they will do is to hedge this asset with other assets that they buy again in the financial market in order to reduce their risk, okay? So this is essentially what is called hedging, which means essentially in order to reduce your risk, you try to replicate the product that you are selling with other products that can match the losses of this portfolio, of this product, okay? Now, if you do this, then what you obtain is that the more you convert to the situation where you have a complete market, the more the risk premium should be zero, okay? And at the same point, the amount of trading in the interbank market when you get to this limit of complete market should diverge, okay? This is essentially in line with what we saw in financial markets. So essentially, there is a reason why as you increase N, as in this direction, you also expect that epsilon should decrease, okay? So you should land on this line of complete markets. So, and then essentially what you understand is that essentially if you put these things together, then the more your markets get complete, the more prices become unstable, the more the volume of interbank trading increases. And this is essentially more or less what has been going on, say, for example, in Iceland, okay, in 2007, 2008. And essentially, you can draw out of this model a phase diagram between, say, what is a stable economy, an economy where the amount, size of the financial sector is not so large, and the instability or and the susceptibility also is not so large, okay? And you can predict that essentially if you have an economy, financial markets, and for example, it is subject to foreign exchange fluctuations, like the one of Iceland, then this will move in this direction. And if it increases in size, it will move in this direction and it will become unstable. Okay, so I think we are done. Let me just give you a take-home message. What you learn from applying statistical mechanics to these economic systems is that essentially most of mathematical economics has been developed with the idea of efficiency in mind, of optimality, okay? But what you learn from statistical mechanics is that there is a trade-off between stability and efficiency. So, and if you push your system to be as efficient as possible, then at some point the system may become unstable, okay? And this is a situation that that was seen also for other systems like ecosystems in a very famous paper by Robert May. But in ecosystems, you find that the ecosystems with a very large diversity of species that live on very few resources. But this is because these are systems that have evolved under this condition for a long time, okay? Whereas in the financial markets, the rules are changing very fast, and the system is does not is a system that has no that is adapting at the same time scale at which it is changing. So it's a very very different system, but it's also a very interesting system. Okay, so so can this model tell anything about the economic crisis like 2008? Yes, it has a lot of, as I was discussing the case of Iceland, say, it tells you that, say, there is a limit to the size of the financial system that beyond which your system becomes unstable, okay? And this is essentially what has been happening in finance with the proliferation of all these assets. And yes, there are other lessons that you can learn on, say, how, for example, in August 2007, all of a sudden, all the banks stopped lending each other money. So there was a, say, collapse of trust in finance. And this you can understand it as a game, okay? So what is happening is that, say, is an agreement, a social norm that at a certain point stopped to be compatible with the incentives of the people. And so, I mean, there are a lot of interesting things that one can learn from studying these models. But I think we should stop here. And I'm sorry, this was... and so I think we should stop here. And I encourage you to attend the colloquium that we have now. And so otherwise we will meet tomorrow for Edgar's lectures, okay? And apologies again for today's change of program.